Okay. Now, last week we began looking at parables that I've grouped under the heading, The Kingdom is Good News for the Needy. And we were looking at the parable of the two debtors in Luke 7:41 to 43. And I want to say a bit more about that, and then we'll move on to the next parable. Now, you'll recall that Jesus told this parable in response to Simon the Pharisee, thinking to himself that Jesus had no business letting this sinful woman touch him as she did when she mopped her tears from his feet and was kissing his feet and anointing her feet, his feet with this expensive oil and ointment. And he's thinking to himself, he's indignant about that and says he's got no business letting that go on. And Jesus tells the parable in response to his thinking that. And the point of the parable is that the degree of love expressed to a forgiver is expected to be proportional to the extent of the debt forgiven. You remember he tells him the thing and he says, who's going to love him more? And he says, I suppose the one that had a bigger debt canceled. He says, you've answered correctly. That's right. That would be the expectation, you see. And Jesus then applies that to explain the woman's extravagant appreciation of him and Simon's lack of appreciation of him. You see, the woman's deep appreciation of Jesus was due to her recognition of the magnitude of her guilt before God. She knew the size of her debt that had been forgiven. So she loved a great deal because she was aware of that. So Jesus justified the woman and her conduct toward him. And in the process, he made a powerful statement about his identity because she's coming over thanking him for the forgiveness that she had received. So he applies it to her, he makes a statement about his identity and about the kingdom's openness to the worst of sinners. As Jesus says in Luke 5:32 and elsewhere, he didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. As I said last week, the kingdom is not reserved for a religious elite. However shamefully one has lived, however one has been mired in something, I don't care what it is. I don't care how shameful it is. But the door is open for that person to join with God in his work and share in all the blessings of the kingdom. That's why this is good news for the needy. Because, as I say, there is no sin that is beyond God's mercy for the penitent. And that's the thing that I think is important. So Jesus does that. Now, Jesus also shares, or he leaves Simon to wonder about his own forgiveness and his relationship with God. Now, whether Simon recognizes it or not, his indifference toward Jesus is a reflection of his lack of forgiveness. Though the contrast in the parable that he tells is between the one who loves much in response to having been forgiven much and the one who loves little in response to having been forgiven little, the question it raises for Simon is whether the one who loves not at all has been forgiven at all. And it's a warning, you see, and it's a warning and a challenge to Simon and to all who share his indifference toward the Lord Jesus. Have you been forgiven? Do you understand? You see, so he leaves Simon. He justifies the woman, makes a statement about himself, but he also leaves Simon in this question with this question of, have you been forgiven at all? Here you show no appreciation for me. All right, let's go on to the next one here. So here, this kingdom is good news for the needy. We have the two debtors. And then I want to look at the parable of the lost sheep. Now, the parable of the lost sheep in Luke 15, 1-7, and in Matthew chapter 18, 12-14, those parables there, they're variations of a parable that Jesus told at different times for different purposes. Now, I plan to discuss Matthew's version of the parable later on under the group of parables that I have living as kingdom participants in relation to others. That's one of the groups I have for parables. So that's where I think Matthew's version of the parable better fits. I think he's telling it for a different purpose there. But this morning I want to look in Luke chapter 15 and the parable of the lost sheep, And Luke chapter 15, verses 1 to 3, those verses, they specify that the parable Jesus is telling is in response to the scribes and Pharisees grumbling against Jesus fraternizing with sinners. That's what triggers the parable. You see that expressly in 15, 1 to 3. That's why he tells it. They're grumbling and complaining that Jesus is mixing or fraternizing with sinners. And then we see in Luke 15, 3 to 7, so he told them this parable. What man of you having 100 sheep, if he's lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he's found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. So when they're complaining about Jesus fraternizing with sinners, he tells them this parable. And Snodgrass, in his book, Stories with Intent, commenting on this, he says, the parable of the lost sheep is an analogical how much more argument. The logic of the parable is this. If, as surely you would agree, a shepherd will go after a lost sheep and rejoice when he finds it, how much more will God search for a lost or strayed person and rejoice when he recovers that person? So this is what Jesus is telling him. Jesus is defending his deliberately associating and eating with people known to be sinners. The God whose kingdom Jesus brings values people so highly that rather than ignore or isolate those people when they're lost in sin, he actively pursues them and rejoices when they repent and thus are recovered. His desire for them, God's desire for those who are lost and are away, is not diminished for those who are lost because he has others. It's not like, okay, this one is away, but I got plenty. His desire for the lost is not diminished by the fact he has others. And that's an important thing that we'll see pop up in fraternizing with the lost. In fraternizing with sinners, Jesus is embodying the Father's love for them. He's embodying that love. Unlike his religious critics, Jesus is living out the Old Testament portrayal of the Father as a shepherd who cares tenderly for his people. This imagery is presented perhaps most forcefully in Ezekiel chapter 34. I don't know if you recall, but in Ezekiel 34, in the first 10 verses of that chapter, the prophet just excoriates the leaders of Israel for failing to serve as proper shepherds. Failing in that regard. Failing to serve as shepherds who seek out the lost and scattered sheep and who feed them. And then he says in Ezekiel 34, 11 through the first part of 16, for thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so will I seek out my sheep, and I will rescue them from all places where they've been scattered. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed. You see, so in his fraternizing with sinners, Jesus is embodying God's love for them. Not like these religious critics, you see. They're not living out this portrayal of God. They're criticizing the one who is living out this portrayal of God. Now, some people in the parable, when we look at that parable, they assume that the shepherd abandoned the 99 sheep, somehow leaving them in peril, that he just left them out there. And then they pile a lot of theological speculation on that, but that's a mistake. You see, the original hearers of the parable, they would have assumed that the shepherd had made some kind of provision for. He doesn't have to say that. They would assume that he had made some kind of provision for the 99, whether leaving them in an enclosure or whether leaving them in the care of another shepherd. Snodgrass says about that idea where people go and want to focus on the 99. He says, parables are marked by focus and brevity and do not care about unnecessary issues. Like all literature, they often have gaps. This parable does not care about any of these questions relating to the 99. And it amazes me sometimes, we look at, and we want to spend the time talking about the 99. And when the point is obvious what he's saying, he says it doesn't care about any of these questions relating to the 99, for it is focused on the certainty of searching and the celebration at finding. Nothing else counts, and to make such issues matters of interpretation is catastrophic, because we are dealing with the Word of God. So if one jumps off on one of those things and starts building things based on that, well, you're misleading people and yourself. Interpretation based on elements not there is almost certainly wrong. So I just wanted to mention, you've no doubt run across that you see that. Now, God certainly values and God is pleased with all who are in the fold. There is no question about that. All who are in relationship with him. But there's something special about recovering what was lost. There's something special about that. See, God seeks them. He pursues them. He is the hound of heaven, as the poem goes, baying relentlessly on their trail. You see, he seeks them. Jesus said in Luke 19:10, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost." So this is the nature of God. This is how he is. This is who he is. And Jesus is simply embodying that. And then we've got these religious critics saying, you know, what's up with this? He shouldn't be fraternizing with the lost. He should be holding them in some kind of quarantine. And he's saying to them, you just don't understand. Kingdom is good news for the needy. Lost sheep. Then we have the lost coin. Okay, the parable of the lost coin. This parable occurs only in Luke 15:8-10. And it follows immediately after the parable of the lost sheep. And Jesus says here, "Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost.' Just so, I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Now, the coin that's referred to here in this parable, this coin is a drachma. It is a small Greek silver coin, and this is the only place in the New Testament where a drachma is mentioned. And it was roughly equivalent in value to a denarius, which, as you know, a denarius was a day's wage for a day laborer. So it's not a great sum, but it's nothing to sneeze at. You see, especially if you're relatively poor. Now, the claim that's sometimes made that the 10 coins, that these were part of a necklace or a headband that was given to the woman at her wedding, it's almost certainly wrong. But you may have heard that, so at least know that in my judgment and the judgment of many other people, that's not something that's probably correct. Houses at that time, they're typically very small. And if they had windows at all, the windows would be small, so the lighting would be quite poor, and that probably contributes to the difficulty, how people would understand the difficulty in trying to find this small coin in the house. And the basic point of the parable, it's the same as in the preceding parable, same as the parable of the lost sheep. But here you see there's a greater emphasis on the diligence of the search. That seems to be, see, something that is stressed here. The diligence, you see, of the search. The woman, what? She sweeps the house. She searches for the coin diligently. Or carefully. That's all stated. This is her activity. She's sweeping. She's really going after it. Searching for the coin diligently. And she persists until she finds the coin. And the parable, it's another analogical how much more? You see, how much more argument. If a woman, if she will expend herself until she finds a lost coin, and she will rejoice when she finds it, will not God much more expend himself in the pursuit of people lost in sin and rejoice when they repent and thus are recovered? If a woman's going to do this for a coin, will not God do more in the search of those who are lost? And again, see, his desire for the lost, it is not diminished by the fact he has others. That does nothing to diminish his interest in and desire for those who are away. And we have to understand that and know it. Well, he has us, that's fine. Well, he does have us, and he's pleased with that, and he rejoices in that. But he's interested in the lost. His interest for them doesn't abate because, well, you know, I got plenty. I got 9 coins. Who cares about the 10th? I got 99 sheep. Who cares about the 100th? He cares. His love for them is not diminished by the fact that he has others. Now, Jesus associating and eating with sinners, it embodies the love and desire for the lost of the God whose kingdom he is bringing. That's what he's doing. He is embodying the love of the lost of the God whose kingdom he's bringing. It is the revolution or the transforming operation of God in which all mankind is sought to participate without regard to their past sinfulness. Again, it doesn't matter who you are, what you did, how long you did it, how despicable you were, how much you hate yourself for having done it. It doesn't matter. The door is open to all who will come. You see, that's the idea. It's open to all who will come, and that's participation in the kingdom. And it is a kingdom from which only impenitence excludes. Only the refusal to repent and turn excludes. You cannot come into the kingdom as a rebel, as one who says, I like this, I'm living this way, and I don't care, but no. But whatever you've done, if you will come to the kingdom in penitence, the door is open. And so it is indeed good news for the needy. Third parable he tells, the lost son. Luke 15:11-32. This parable of the lost son, it occurs only here, and it follows immediately on after the parable of the lost coin. Now this and the parable of the Good Samaritan, these are probably the most loved and most influential of all of the Lord's parables. Now, Snodgrass's proposed title for this parable may be more fitting. He calls it the parable of the compassionate father and his 2 lost sons. So that may be more fitting. Now, it's important to remember that this is the last of 3 parables that Jesus tells in response to the Pharisees and scribes grumbling against him for fraternizing with sinners. Now, I'll comment on the parable in sections. I'll go through and just read and talk about each of the sections. Luke 15:11-13. And he said, there was a man who had 2 sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. Now, in the normal circumstance, we have a father here who has 2 sons. In a normal circumstance, when the father died, the older son would inherit 2/3 of his property, and the younger son would inherit 1/3. The older son would have the primary responsibility of caring for the father and the mother, but would have the primary responsibility of caring for the father during his old age, but the younger son also would have some responsibility in that regard. Now, this is something that's probably so lost in our culture, the sense of the son, the children, being obligated to care for the parents. And this is something that was understood there, but the older son would have the primary responsibility, but the younger son would also share some of that responsibility. Now, it was possible for a person to grant property during his lifetime to a presumed heir. It was possible for that to happen, but that would be very unusual. Okay, this would be something that would be very unusual. So when Jesus sets this up in the parable, people are saying that's possible, but okay, this is something that's pretty quirky and it would be unusual. And for a son to ask for that to be done, it would be brash to say the least. All right, for the son to come and say, hey, why don't we go ahead and get on with it and you go ahead and give me my share of the property. It would be brash to say the least. Now, the younger son here, he not only asks for and receives his share of the father's, receives his share during the father's lifetime, though perhaps his interest in the land wasn't included. In other words, what he's giving him may just be the personalty, not the realty. That's certainly possible. But in any event, the son comes and he asks for and he receives his share during the father's lifetime. He then moves away. See, so as to be unavailable to discharge his responsibility to help care for his father. So he takes part of the assets by asking for them before the father passes. He takes part of the assets that the father would have had, he otherwise would have had at his disposal during his life. So he's taking all this wealth that would have been there for his father to use during his life. He not only takes that prematurely, he then goes off somewhere where he's not available to help discharge his responsibility to his father, but neither is the wealth that he took with him. See, so this is what's going on here. Snodgrass remarks, he says, the boy may not have literally wished his father dead, but his actions show that he did not really care for his father or desire a relationship with him. He wanted the father's money, not the father. Now, in dividing the property between the two sons, it seems clear that the assignment the father made to the older son would not take effect until the father's death. See, this is analogous to what we would call a transfer subject to a life estate. In other words, if I give somebody property, I can retain the right to live on the property and the land and to use it during the period of my life. And so that's what's happening here. He makes the transfer to the older son. He transfers that portion to him at that time, but the transfer was subject to the father's right to make full use of the property during his life. You see, so he gives the son the stuff, but he has what is in essence a life estate. I get to continue using it. The transfer to you has already taken place. Upon my death, it's yours, but until my death, I get to use it. You see, so the younger son took his stuff and went out. See, he took it away, so it was no longer available for the father to use. And see, that's why the father could still reinstate the younger son and give orders about the banquet. You say, well, if he already gave the property away, how can he been saying, slaughter this, do this? How can he be managing the property? Because he still controls it, though he had given what we would say the title to the older son. You see, he still has the right to say, butcher that, do this, because he has, well, as I say, what is in essence a life estate. And it also explains why the older son complains about his not having received anything. I could see us saying that. If we receive property and it was subject to a life estate where the father got to live in it and do what he wanted to with it until he died, even though the transfer had already been made to us, I could see us saying, well, I didn't get anything. How does it matter to me? It's just like it was before. You're still here calling all the shots and running everything, and I don't have control over the wealth, even though it's been actually given to me already, and when I die, it's automatically mine. You see, so I could see that's what's going on, I think, with that. Now, the younger son, he takes his chunk, like I said, possibly excluding his one-third interest in the real property, But he takes the wealth that had been given to him prematurely. He takes it and he squanders it in this faraway place. He squanders it in wasteful, reckless, or wild living. However you want to cut it, it is not the kind of living that you would be proud of your son doing. You see, the kind of living for which you'd be proud of your son. Now, this may have included immoral living, you see, and I'm guessing, just knowing people, that it did. And at least the older brother accuses him of immoral living in verse 30, but the Greek word that's used does not require that, okay? But in any event, you have it being wasteful, reckless, and wild. And the younger son's hardship, it's told in 15, 14 to 16. And when he had spent everything, so he's got this wealth, these assets, he takes them. He goes off to this far country. He's going to go and live. And it says, and when he had spent everything, so he just wasted the money, squandered it, no planning, no longer available for the father or anything. A severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. I just love the way the Lord, I mean, these parables are just beautiful. He sends him out to feed pigs, and he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. All right, after he wasted his money, all of this money that he had brashly, prematurely got his father to give him, after he'd wasted that money in self-indulgence, a famine arose and he had nothing to fall back on. He had lived foolishly. He just, you know, like we'd say, spending money like a drunken sailor. Apologies to you drunken sailors, but you know that I'm telling you the truth. I know who you are. But, you know, he's out here. He had wasted this. He had lived foolishly, and he's reduced to hiring himself out as a servant to one of the citizens of that country, a Gentile, who sends him out to feed his pigs. Now, his desperation is marked by the fact that he's feeding pigs. You see, in the Old Testament prohibited eating meat of pigs, and it prohibited touching a pig carcass. But by the first century, that had morphed into a complete ban on rearing pigs. You know how the Pharisees and things operated. They would build fences and stuff around rules and laws. So this was considered something to be rearing pigs that was considered unclean, inappropriate, but that's part of the power of it. The desperation of his situation is reflected in the fact that he would stoop to feeding pigs. So somebody hearing this saying, this boy's at the end. If he's willing to do this, well, then he's really at the end. Okay, now he'd sunk so low, by the way, that he longed to eat what he was feeding the pigs. He envied the pigs. Now, how's that for punch for a story? Here, what's happened to this guy? He's at the point of envying pigs, the unclean animal, and he's envying them, longing for what they eat. He's giving them something. He's longing for what they have. But nobody gives him anything, so he's left worse off than pigs. All right, so that's where he is. The son then comes to his senses. 15, 17 to 19. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. So here he is, stooping to being a hired servant of a Gentile and enduring the defiling task of feeding pigs, and yet he's still struggling to get enough food to sustain himself. He's gone that low and is still starving to death. So he's in quite the situation. And then it dawns on him. The NIV, I think, says he comes to his senses. You see, it dawns on him that his father has hired servants, and his servants always had more than enough to eat. So I'm here starving to death in this horrible situation. Man, my father has servants who always have more than enough to eat. So I'd be better off returning to my father, confessing my sin, and working as one of my hired father's servants. I'm working for this Gentile in a pig pen, and I'm starving to death. So why not go back and confess my sin to my father and then take on the role of one of his servants? Then I'll have enough to eat. So this is the thinking, and it all makes perfect sense. Now, some claim that the son's repentance here wasn't sincere, but that it was a calculated maneuver designed simply to improve his situation. He's not really penitent. You know, he doesn't really. He's just trying to get into a better physical situation. But that seems unlikely. And it seems unlikely because "I have sinned" is a common way in the Old Testament of expression of sincere confession. You see that phrase, "I have sinned," many times in the Old Testament where it is an expression of sincere penitence, sincere confession. So I don't think that that should be read into it. You see, in the son's sin against heaven and his father, it was his failure to honor his father. That's what his sin is. He clearly sinned, and he comes and he says, "I've sinned against heaven and before you," and his sin is his failure to honor his father as required in Exodus 20:12 and Deuteronomy 5:16. He dishonored his father. He dishonored his father, if not by seeking his inheritance prematurely, then certainly by turning his back on his responsibility to help care for him, and by squandering the means to do so in self-indulgent living and possibly in more overt sinful living, as the older son accused him of. So certainly he's dishonored his father. He treated him like, "Hey, why don't you just give me my stuff now? I will gather it up. It will no longer be at your disposal during your life. I'm going to go off where I don't have to discharge my responsibility to you. And on top of that, I'm going to blow it all. So it will not be available for whatever help you need. There'll be no nursing home for you, Dad, because I've decided to blow all that you've given me. And I don't care about my responsibility." This is what's going on. Arlen Hultgren, in his book on the parables of Jesus, he says, "It is not said what the young man's sin might be. While the modern interpreter imagines easily that it had to do with his way of life in the far country, the ancient storyteller and hearer might think otherwise. For them, the sin of the younger son would more likely be his insolence in leaving home with his share of the property and therefore not providing for his father in old age as the commandment requires. Such a view becomes even more probable in light of the elder brother's statement in 1530 when he speaks of the younger brother's devouring the father's property. This property that should have been available to help you, he not only took it prematurely, he squandered it. So now whatever help it might have been to you in your old age, this guy's made sure that'll never happen because he's blown it on himself in just irresponsible, wasteful living." You see, an ancient culture hearing that would know this son has done bad stuff. You see, this son has dishonored his father. That doesn't strike us as a big deal. But the ancient culture was a culture of shame and honor, and it had much more punch. You see, so we tend to say, well, no, sin had to be something he did over here. And I don't doubt that he did things over here, but I think that misses the thrust of what the sin is, and it's dishonoring the father here. He says, "Such a view becomes even more probable in light of the elder brother's statement in 1530 in which he speaks to the younger brother devouring your property, precisely that which was to be used to maintain the father beyond his working years when he turns the farm over to his sons." Well, that stuff is gone. That property's gone. Now, the son's return is told in Luke 15:20-24. "And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fattened calf and kill it and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Now that you see why this parable is so loved. You see why this parable is so loved and why this parable is so influential. The son returns and the father sees him while he's still a long way off. Which may imply, doesn't say that, but the fact he sees him when he's a long way off, it may imply that he was hoping for his return. And rather than anger or resentment over how the son had treated him, emotions on the part of the father that everybody hearing this parable would have understood. Because they would have said, this son blew his nose on you. And here you are. Without any of those emotions, any of that resentment, any of that anger, they would have understood that. And here, despite how he was treated, the father feels compassion toward his son. He runs toward the son, see, which was considered improper and undignified for an older man. Because to do that, he's got to gather up his robe and run, which exposes his legs. So he didn't care that it would appear undignified, right? He's like, well, I'm going to stand. This is more important to me that these people not think I'm undignified. Out the window, baby. Here's my son. And he's just running for him. You see that attitude and that spirit there. He just runs for him. And then he embraces and kisses him. And the father's filled with joy at this sinful son's return. You see, assuming in hope spawned by love, what the hearer of the parable knows to be a fact, and that is that the son has come seeking reconciliation. You say, well, how does he know why the son's coming? He doesn't know, he hopes. Now, we know why the son's coming because we're hearing the parable. But the father, in this hope spawned by love, when he sees the son, that's what he's thinking. That's what he wants to be the case. And he runs to greet him. And the son begins his spiel, right? He'd already rehearsed this. This is what I'm going to say. I'm not worthy. This, that, you know, just make me the hired servant. All that. The son begins his spiel, but when he says he's no longer worthy to be called the father's son, the father interrupts and he orders various honor-bestowing acts to be done for the son to leave no doubt that the son is an honored member of the family. That's what these things are. These are honor bestowing acts. That's what the robe, the ring, the shoes, or the sandals on the feet. He says, quick, bring this. Bring the robe. Bring the ring. Put shoes on his feet. Those are acts that bestow honor on the returning son. They are emblems of the fullness of the reception. You see, it is not moral quarantine. It is not that, yes, you are welcome back, but you are welcome back on probation because you have done wrong. So now you come into a limbo period, and if you are right and good for long enough, then maybe you'll come back to a full relationship with me. That is not how it goes. You see, restoration upon repentance. You see, what? Just like there was never anything. You've come back. Full, these emblems of full reception by God. That is how we are. You see, that is how God takes us and receives us. The father orders a celebration meal in honor of this joyful occasion of the son's return. The father's heart, it's just bursting, you see, with uncontainable joy. And I'm going to try to get in the younger. I heard that bell. Okay. Now the scene shifts, okay, to the older brother. I'm going to have to go fast. Now his older son was in the field, and he came and drew near to the house. He heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and your father's killed the fattened calf because he's received him back safe and sound. But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father. You see this? His father's entreating him. What's he saying to his father? Ixnay. No. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, look, these many years I've served you, and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. See, that's this life estate idea. He divided the property. How? He divided the property, but he retained control over them. So yes, he never gave him anything in that sense, although the quote title had passed. All right. But when his son of yours, but when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. And he said to him, son, you're always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad. For this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. See, the father's desire for his younger son, despite his having been lost and dead in sin, and his great joy at his son's return. You see, this parallels those points from the parable of the lost sheep and the lost coin. The son didn't cease to be valuable to the father because he was away. Those who are lost in sin don't cease to be valuable to God. It's not like God is saying, well, what do I care about you? Yes, you're out in sin, so who cares? I'm with these guys. They love me and care about me. You're off over there and I don't care a thing about you. That is not true. You see, that is not true. He continues to care about them. The son didn't cease to be valuable because he was away and estranged. He remained precious to the father, as evident by the father's joy when he returns. If the father didn't care about him, there wouldn't be this celebration, but the father cares greatly about him. The oldest son is angry over his father's reception of the younger brother, and he resents his celebrating his return. Why should his return be celebrated when he shouldn't have done what he did in the first place? Why should his return be celebrated? If anybody's to be celebrated over, it should be the one who didn't mistreat and dishonor the father. Why does this become a predicate to a celebration? He shouldn't have done that. So how does that warrant celebrating when he returns? And the father tells him that his joyful reception of the younger son in no way takes away from his position. You see, it doesn't do that. It's not a zero-sum game where what he gets, you lose. It doesn't do that. It doesn't affect that, you see. But celebration was called for. Because the return of something as precious as a son who's been lost or dead is an inherently joyful thing. It's called for. It's right. It's fitting. It's proper. Because celebration of something that important that returns is inherently joyful. It would be wrong not to celebrate and wrong not to be glad on this occasion. Let me finish this. I heard that bell. Let me say this. I'll say a little bit more next week. But I want you to get this connection. You see, the older brother's attitude is precisely the attitude of the Pharisees and scribes that they have, how they saw sinners. It's their attitude toward sinners, toward those they saw as sinners, those who lived unholy and shameful lives. You see, this is their attitude. They objected to Jesus fraternizing with such people because they did not share the Father's love for those people. You see, in their mind, the sinner's blatant mistreatment and dishonoring of God made them unworthy of actively pursuing, let alone rejoicing over when they return. It is exactly the older brother. They're jumping on Jesus for fraternizing with sinners, and they show in that they don't share the Father's love for them. You see, they want them to be treated just the way the older brother's saying. He did wrong. He shouldn't be sought after. He shouldn't be celebrated. And Jesus is embodying God the Father saying, I love them. They continue to be important to me. And when they come home, it's a party. You see, and the church, this is what we do. We go and tell people the kingdom is for all people. I'm over time. Sorry. Thank you.